Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is the 15th of January, the second Sunday after Epiphany.
Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to our worship service this morning. And a special welcome to our visitors. If you're new in the Springfield, Pollock County area, are looking for a new church home, we invite you to make St. John your new church home. Once again, as we started last week, we are returning to setting four in the ELW, which is the old setting two that we used all the time in the LBW. Unfortunately, for setting four, they leave out the Eucharistic prayers. You really don't need to turn to it because there's only one response, and it's the same cue as you always have. Let us therefore proclaim the mystery of faith. You just respond, Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. So instead of flipping back and forth from 150 whatever back to 130 to the Eucharistic prayer and then have to go back to 150 something, you can just stay and set in four and just do the response that you're using. We begin with preparing our hearts and minds for worship with the order of confession and forgiveness. So I'd ask that those who can do so without difficulty, please stand as we prepare our hearts and minds to worship our Lord. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom our hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, clothe the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you, and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and command for ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and make us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. We now begin to worship with Here I Am, Lord, hymn number 574 in the back of your worship. Hymn number 574, Here I Am.
By Daniel Schutte in 1946, a favorite hymn, direct quote from the Bible. Samuel heard God's voice, and we hear God's voice, and we're supposed to respond to it. We're here today responding to God's voice, praying for the people who aren't here, praying for our country, praying for our world. Here I am, Lord, St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio.
Thank you.
the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Thank you. Second reading today is from the first chapter of 1 Corinthians. Paul, called to be an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and a brother Sosthenes, to the church of God that is in Corinth, to those who are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints, together with all those who are in every place, call in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, both their Lord and ours. Grace to you, peace from God our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ. I give thanks to my God because of the grace of God that has been given to you in Christ Jesus. For in every way you have been enriched in him, in speech and knowledge of every kind, just as the testimony of Christ has been strengthened among you, so that you are not lacking in any spiritual gift as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ, who also strengthened you to the end, so that you may be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful. By him you will be called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our pastor is Pastor John Pollock. He'll be reading the scripture today. This is the second Sunday after the Epiphany. We're emphasizing the baptism of Jesus and the beginning of his earthly ministry.
The Gospel according to St. John, the first chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. John the Baptist saw Jesus coming toward him and declared, "Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, after me comes a man who ranks ahead of me because he was before me. I myself did not know him, but I came baptizing with water for this reason, that he might be revealed to Israel." And John testified, "I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it remained on him. I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water said to me, 'He on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain is the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit.' And I myself have seen and have testified that this is the Son of God." The next day, John again was standing with two of his disciples, and he watched Jesus walk by. He exclaimed, "Look, here is the Lamb of God." The two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus. When Jesus turned and saw them following, he said to them, "What are you looking for?" They said to him, "Rabbi," which translated means teacher, "where are you staying?" He said to them, "Come and see." They came and saw where he was staying, and they remained with him that day. It was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. One of the two who heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first found his brother Simon and said to him, "We have found the Messiah," which is translated anointed. He brought Simon to Jesus, who looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You are to be called Cephas," which is translated Peter. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Christ.
You may be seated. Just one announcement this morning to share with you, that is a reminder that confirmation instruction will begin this coming Saturday, 21st of January, 10:30. If you have someone 7th grade or above who needs instruction, please bring them to the library entrance, and I will meet you there. Students up to class. So that is this Saturday, beginning at 10:30. That's now that you give your attention to the Lord.
Oh,
Unfortunately, it was not printed on the reading insert this morning, so we will either need to open up your own Bible or pew Bible to the text if you wish to follow along. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. What makes up the church? When asked this question, one pastor replied by saying the church is made up of pillars and caterpillars. The pillars hold up the church. The caterpillars just go in and out. Another pastor asked the same question, responded by saying the great task of the church is to bring sinners into heaven and to get the members out of bed. What makes up the church? How would you answer that question if someone came up to you and asked you to explain to them what makes up the church? In order to give a solid answer, a theological answer, the answer that the Word of God teaches us as to what makes up the church, we turn to our second reading for today, that first chapter of St. Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, and focus on verse 2. For in this second verse, St. Paul explains to us what makes up the church. Again, hear the words that St. Paul wrote, inspired by the Holy Spirit, when he said, to the church of God that is in Corinth, to those sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints together with all those who in every place call upon the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, both their Lord and ours. So, what makes up the church? What St. Paul tells us is the first thing that makes up the church are people who are sanctified. To the church of God that is in Corinth, to those sanctified in Christ Jesus. So what does that mean? What does it mean to be sanctified? The word means to withdraw from fellowship with the world and to have fellowship with God. It means to be separated to God. It means to be separated from evil things and evil ways. Or it means to be dedicated to God. So, how does this sanctification take place? It takes place through the power of the Holy Spirit. As we read in the small catechism, the explanation to the third article of the Creed, I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the dead, and the life everlasting. We read in that explanation, quote, the Holy Spirit sanctifies and keeps us in the true faith the same way it calls, gathers, and enlightens and sanctifies the whole Christian church on earth. Okay. Now, how does that happen? How does the Holy Spirit sanctify and enlighten and call and gather the whole Christian church on earth? Again, we turn to the explanation of our small catechism, and it says, the Holy Spirit calls us through the gospel and enlightens us with its gift. As we plainly can see, the entire work of sanctification is the work of God through the Holy Spirit. That the sanctification of the believer is brought about by the Word of God through faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, and through the power of the Holy Spirit working in us. It is also plain to see that we have absolutely nothing to do with our sanctification. We are not more sanctified than somebody else because we don't dance or play cards or go to the beach or go to the movies or all these things the holiness denominations used to tell us when we were growing up as kids that you had to not do in order to be sanctified. We don't do anything to be sanctified. We can't do anything. We can't add to it. We can't improve on it. We have nothing. No pardon. It's all the work of God's love for us. Remember member of the Sanhedrin comes to see Jesus at night. And he questions Jesus about his teachings and so forth. And Jesus says in that third chapter, I tell you the truth, unless you are born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. Or more accurate translation is, unless you are born from above, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. This totally confuses Nicodemus. He says to Jesus, can I enter my mother's womb again and be born over again? He has no idea how this can happen. So Jesus answers him. And this verse is from the New Living Translation instead of the ESV, which I usually use, because it makes it most plain as to what Jesus is saying. And Jesus says, I assure you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and the Spirit. Humans can reproduce only human life. Remember that. Humans can only reproduce human life. But the Holy Spirit gives birth to spiritual life. So only the Holy Spirit can sanctify us. We can't do a thing to bring about our sanctification. It's all the work of God through the Holy Spirit. As Jesus says, we must be born of water and the Spirit. Baptism. In baptism, God adopts us as his child. The Holy Spirit plants a seed of faith. And it's the parents' responsibility then to raise us up in the Christian home and bring us to church and Sunday school and vacation Bible school. If we are older when we are baptized, then it's our responsibility to continue in the community of faith, all while being a sanctified follower of Jesus Christ. So, what makes up the church? Number one, people who are sanctified. Sanctified how? By the working of the Holy Spirit. Second element that makes up the church are people who are called. Again, as we read, to those sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints. Now, what does that word call mean? It means to be invited into something. It means to be welcomed into a group. It means to conform to God's saving purpose. So once again, we see the emphasis on the action of God through Jesus, faith in Jesus, and the working of the Holy Spirit. God calls you first through the waters of your baptism, adopting you as his child and an heir to the kingdom. This call and invitation continues as you grow older, as the Holy Spirit calls you through the gospel, enlightening with you with its gifts, and sanctifying and keeping you in the true faith. So what we see is that God is a God of invitation. God is a God who is constantly inviting us to be part of his community of faith. I don't know why in this country, because this is the only one that I have any experience in. I don't know what it's like in Europe or any place else. But I don't know why in this country, especially when I was growing up, and those of you my age, a few years younger, a few years older, you'll remember this. But why in America we developed this picture of God as being this fearful, terrible judge. And so often in the 50s and early 60s, all we heard about was hellfire and damnation. Hellfire and brimstone. We didn't hear about God being an inviting God. We didn't hear about God being a God who constantly wants us to be in this community of faith. Instead, God was painted as this awesome judge who was just waiting for us to step out of line. But what Scripture shows us is that God is an inviting God. And not just in the New Testament through Jesus Christ. But you go all the way back from Genesis to Revelation, it's the same message that God is this inviting God. God invites Abraham to be the father of a great nation. God invites the different people, Joseph and people afterwards, the patriarchs, to continue that promise to Abraham. God invites Moses to be the liberator of the Hebrew children enslaved by Egypt, by Pharaoh in Egypt. God invites the different judges then to defend Israel, people like Samson and Deborah and others that we read about who defended the young nation as it was developing. God, when the people of Israel tell God they want to have a king so they can be like other nations, God invites Saul to be the first king. Unfortunately, Saul fails. So God then calls David. And David becomes the beloved of the Lord. And the Lord promises David that from his lineage will come the Messiah, the Savior of the world. We see God invite the prophets to proclaim his message to the people when they turn away from their covenant with God. And we see God through the prophets constantly inviting the Hebrew children to come back to him and to be loved by him and protected by him. But so often they reject his invitation. And then in the New Testament, we see Jesus revealing again that God is an inviting God as he invites 12 men to be his first disciples. He continues to invite people to come into the community of faith. And as St. Paul tells us in, later on in his letter to the Corinthians, how when Jesus rose from the dead, he appeared first to Peter and the apostles and then to 500. Who believed. And then lastly, Paul himself. And so God is an inviting God. He's constantly calling us. Jesus knocks on the door of our heart, asking to come in. The Holy Spirit constantly calls us through the gospel to come to faith, to accept that invitation that God has so graciously made, not because we deserve it, not because we've earned it, but because of God's great love for us. So the people who make up the church are people who are called. Upon answering the invitation, we are nourished then by the reading and preaching of God's word and nourished at the supper of our Lord, where our faith is refurbished, where our faith is strengthened and nourished, just like we sit down every day and eat physical food to nourish our physical bodies. If we stop eating, we damage our bodies. Throughout history, we've had those people who've gone on hunger strikes in order to make some type of social or political or even religious point. And as they continued to deny themselves food, their bodies began to shrivel up and all kinds of things begin to happen to their organs because they weren't receiving the nourishment they need. It's just like our faith. We cannot have faith and then just ignore the nourishment. We need to gather together to hear God's word read and proclaimed and to gather at that table. This is why it's important to attend worship. All of us here probably have a family member or a friend who ought to be here this morning or should have been here at 8 o'clock, who consider themselves members of this congregation, but we never see them. And when they ask the question, well, do I have to go to worship to be a Christian? The answer is technically no. I mean, throughout history, we have had hermits, those people who, in order to be more, they felt to be more committed to Jesus Christ. They went off and lived by themselves on a mountain or on top of some perch somewhere or way out in the desert where they weren't around anybody. But Scripture shows us the true church is meeting in the community of faith to worship. And so if they ask you, what do I really need to go to worship to be a believer? You say, no, but if you want your faith strengthened, if you want your faith to be ready to help you during your trials and tribulations, through your disappointments and discouragements, if you want your faith to be able to be there and help you through hard times, as well as being there for the joys and the victories and the wonderful things, you have to nourish it just like you nourish your physical body. There's a story told about Dr. Martin Luther that when he was, as most of you know, I think that even though Luther became a professor at the University of Wittenberg, he still was the church in Wittenberg. And there was a fellow who had been missing Mass, and had missed Mass for some time. So one day, Luther was walking, and he came by that person's house, so he knocked on the door, and the wife answered the door. And Luther asked if he could come in and see her husband, and she said, well, of course, Dr. Luther, or Father Luther, he's in there sitting by the fire. So Martin Luther went in, and the fellow acknowledged and said, hello, Father, how are you? Luther said, fine. And then Luther went over to the fire, and he took the tongs, and he reached into the fire and pulled out an ember, and he laid it on the hearth, and he went down and sat down. The lax church member and Dr. Luther watched as that ember went from glowing bright red to slowly becoming darker and darker and darker and darker until it went out. Once it had gone out, Dr. Luther then got up, took the tongs again, picked up the ember, and placed it back in the fire. As soon as he placed it in the fire, it immediately exploded into bright red flame and began burning again and putting off heat. The lax church member looked at Dr. Luther and he said, Father Luther, you don't need to say another word. I will be in Mass Sunday morning. That is the way it is with the community of faith. When we take ourselves away from worship, we risk being like an ember taken out of a fire and losing the fire of our faith. We risk losing that faith that will be with us and be our rock when we go through the changes and chances of life. And so when somebody asks you, why do I need to go to worship? That is the answer you can give them, or the illustration you can give. It's like taking an ember or a log out of a fire. It sits out, it goes out. It's no longer of use. You don't want that to happen to your faith. And so you want to be part of the fire. And that's what gathering together in worship is for. To reignite our faith, to strengthen our faith, to nourish our faith. Not just through the reading of the word and the proclamation of the word and receiving the Lord's Supper, but also having fellowship with one another. Of knowing one another's trials and difficulties, and yet seeing each other in worship and gathering strength from each other because of what you and they have gone through. So the people that make up the church are the people who are called. The people invited by God. And that invitation is for all people. Wherever they may be. It's not just for a select group. It's for everyone. Every race, every creed, every color, every nationality, every language, every ethnic group, every socioeconomic group, every educational level, every lack of educational level. From the most productive and the most advanced societies to the most primitive, the invitation is there for you. So what makes up the church are people who are sanctified and called. And the third element of the church is the people who are saints. To those sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints together with all those in every place. Saints. Now when you use the word saints, sometimes people become confused. They think you're talking about either those who have died, gone before us in the faith, or they think you're talking about those people whom the church has designated as saints because of their special witness about Jesus Christ. St. Peter, St. Paul, St. James and John, St. John the Baptist, St. Mary Magdalene, Mary the Mother of our Lord. Then you get into the early church fathers, St. Jerome, St. Augustine, St. Gregory, and so forth. But that's not what we mean. That's not what St. Paul means as he writes this letter. Now, the literal meaning of the word saint or saints is those devoted to the service of God. It means to be separated from the world or set aside from the world for service to God. It means to be set apart from the world to honor and love God. It means to share in God's purity and to abstain from earth's defilement. That's the technical meaning of saint. With the power of the Holy Spirit, we try to live in God's purity and abstain from earth's defilements by being human we fail. That's why we come to Jesus in repentance and ask to be forgiven. But the Holy Spirit helps us so we do not face a life of being dominated by sin. As St. Paul uses the word then in his epistles, he narrows it a little bit more into simply meaning all who believe in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. So the third element of what makes up the church are the saints, all those who believe in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. The saying of the second pastor, I said, who said that the great task of the church is to bring sinners into heaven and to get the members of out of bed. The actual what he said was to get the saints out of bed. But I didn't use the word saints because I said it to somebody during the week, right about him, and they didn't know what I meant. They were totally confused until I explained to them saint meaning all of us who believe. So that's why I changed it to members. But that's how St. Paul's using it. All of us. We're all saints because we believe in Jesus Christ. And that's the third element of what makes up the church. All who believe in Jesus Christ as the atoning sacrifice for our sins, who believe that his rising from the dead, he conquered death so that we might have eternal life, and all those who believe he ascended into heaven and will come again in glory are saints. Again, like sanctification and like being called, this is all an action of God through faith in our Lord Jesus Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit. So, through this faith, we reap the benefits of Jesus Christ. We reap the benefit of his crucifixion, paying the debt of sin that we owe. We reap the benefits of his resurrection, having that gift of everlasting life. We reap the benefits of his ascension, knowing that when he comes again in glory, we do not have to fear his judgment because we are already his children, part of the heavenly kingdom, children of the heavenly Father. So that is what makes up the church. What makes up the church are not perfect people. What makes up the church are not overly pious people. What makes up the church are not I am better than you are people. But what makes up the church are ordinary people like you and me and every other member of the church of Jesus Christ. What makes up the church are people who are sanctified, called, and made saints through their faith in Jesus Christ. So if someone comes to you and asks you, what makes up the church? You can answer confidently with the words, the church is made up of the sanctified, the called, and those who have become saints through the power of faith in Jesus Christ. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen.
For those who can, without the body, please stand as we confess our faith.
We acknowledge one another. forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray that the dawn from on high will shine upon the church, the world, and all those in need. Our response today is, hear our prayer. Enrich your church, gracious God, with a diversity of peoples and cultures from around the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Infuse the nations of the world with the spirit of unity. Help them to consider consequences for future generations as the earth's resources are consumed. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Open our ears to your call and fill us with your spirit, that we may follow in the path of discipleship, having the courage to come and see where Christ lives. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give renewal of strength to the sick and infirm. Help us to be active in our concern for them through visits and caring deeds. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Embolden this congregation's witness as a community that proclaims that Messiah is in our midst. Help us to love extravagantly and to serve unconditionally. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Entrust your faithful servants with an awareness of your grace in life and in death. We give thanks to you for those who have died in the faith and for all who are welcomed into your eternal presence. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Time for our offering, taken up by Helen Wallace and Sharon Leach. We welcome you to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. We're here to worship God. We're singing a song now at the end, and it's about the end of time. We will hope and pray that God will spare us and allow us to return to him here on earth and establish his kingdom on earth. As things are difficult, we pray for a great revival to come to our soul. Continue to do God's will, pray for others, do good, look to the poor, as God has said through the Bible, orphans, aliens, any of those who need help. Love our neighbors as ourselves. We thank you, Jesus Christ, for dying for us on the cross. Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. We emphasize today Jesus' baptism and his call to the church. We are the church here on earth. We will continue to be at least two or three gathered together, and as many as we can get to come to worship. This is what God asks us to do, and it's for our own good because we love him. He wants us to be near him, and we are the happiest when we're near him. The pastor has prepared the elements of Holy Communion. We receive Jesus today, and through this receiving of him, we become one with him, as he will be with us forever.
Congregation, we're invited and encouraged to come forward with us this day as we gather to take of our Lord. We continue our celebration with a great thanksgiving on page 152 in the front of your worship. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Thank you.
body of our Lord Jesus Christ and his precious blood, strengthen, preserve you in true faith unto life eternal.
Amen.
Let us pray. O God, we give you thanks that you have set before us this feast, the body and blood of your Son. By your Spirit, strengthen us to serve all in need and to give ourselves away as bread for the hungry. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
We conclude our celebration with soon, very soon, hymn number 439 in the back of your worship. Hymn number 439.
This hymn was written by an American hymn writer, Andrew Crouch, and he's a genius that he was able to get the total spirit of the plantation songs. But this was written by an American songwriter, American hymn writer, Andrew Crouch. It's about the end of times. Meditate on this and pray that God will spare us from the end times, allow us to repent and return to him. This is the end of times song. Sing it through your heart, written by Andre Crouch. Second Sunday after the Epiphany, when the wise men came and God was known to be incarnate, and we have our epiphanies through our lives when we recognize God. We had this wonderful last hymn, we're going to see the King, so no matter what happens, God is King. We will see him either when we die or with the second coming. But many people believe the end of times are near, and this is a song that glorifies that. We have our services here at St. John's Church. Holy Communion is celebrated the first and third Sunday of each month, festivals, and each Wednesday evening at 6:30 in the chapel, we have Holy Communion. We invite you to come at any time as we continue to worship God, continue to keep God in our midst, keep We need a revival. We need to return to God. As God certainly has the right to be angry with us, we need to worship Him more often. We pray for those who are unable to worship, and we pray for those who are indifferent. We pray that people be sanctified, return to God, because this is what God wants for us. He wants us to return to Him. We have flowers today. We always have fresh flowers on the altar. Flowers today are presented by Cindy and Les Pearson and family in honor of Luke Everhart's birthday. Happy birthday, Luke Everhart. These are your flowers for today. Linda Fox in honor of granddaughter Devin and grandson DJ's birthday. So a lot of birthdays here in January. My birthday was January 11th. My granddaughter's birthday, January 11th. Very popular month to be born, January. And we have flowers today given in honor of those people who are relatives of members of our congregation in honor of Luke Everhart's birthday. Linda Fox in honor of granddaughter Devin and grandson DJ's birthday. We're glad that you could worship with us today and that you received virtual communion, to receive the body and blood. Just pray and Jesus will come into your heart, make Him Lord of your life. Just say, Lord, I believe, I will repent, believe, love God, love my neighbor, be baptized, all the things that you ask me to do. Read the scripture and it will be with you and you will be with me and it will give me happiness for now and forever. Also, we can worship and sanctify others through our worship. Continue to be witnesses to God, as Jesus has said, throughout the world, everywhere. We witness our faith in God. God loves us. We love our neighbor. This is all that we need to do. Love God with all of our whole heart and love our neighbors as ourselves. Come to St. John's on 8 o'clock service, 10:30 service every Sunday, 6:30 every Wednesday. We'll worship God and come here and help us to feed the poor, rainbow table, and call the office to volunteer as we give out food and goods to the poor as God has commanded us in His scripture. I'm Dr. Sally Abbott, your announcer. Linda Fox is your videographer. James Pomfusius is the assistant. Karen Dietrich assists. We're happy to bring our ministry on YouTube to you. Please ask others to watch this.